Hello, everybody. Welcome back from lunch. For those of you that were lucky enough to take lunch, for the online audience, thank you very much for joining us. We greatly appreciate your presence here. My name is Bruce Johnson. I am the Vice President of Technology for ObjectSharp. We are a training consulting company here in Toronto. We specialize in, mostly we specialize in things that relate to Microsoft technology. So .NET development, SQL Server, SharePoint, Azure, BizTalk. We tend to run the gamut of that whole particular area. And I'm going to be talking a little bit about virtual machines today, talk about Windows Azure virtual machines, to be precise, a little bit about exactly how those are set up. These are fairly new in the Azure space and are, they fill, if you actually take a look at the entire gamut of how Azure fills out your deployment environment, they actually fit kind of the high-end niche for the way you want to be able to pushing things out. This is pure imagination is a social event, and so you are recommended, requested, encouraged. I could probably come up with another few adverbs for you to get involved. You can follow Purely Imagine on Twitter if you want to tweet about this. The hashtag is #Win8PI. For this particular session, it's actually also, this is Cloud 2, so it's Cloud 2 PI, but the last time I checked, nobody has tweeted. It depends on how you want to look at it. The interesting thing about just simply the way the technology flows, I actually have, besides the laptop that you're seeing up here, we've also got Surface that I've actually got the Twitter stream kicking around, so if people have questions, either online or not, they're more than welcome to pop them up, and I will keep an eye on it and see what we can see. So as I kind of started off with, the idea with if you take a look at the Windows Azure, and I kind of break the lifespan of Windows Azure into kind of two groups. There's anything that happened prior to June of this year, and there's everything afterwards. Okay, because if you haven't taken a look at Azure since June, you really haven't seen what it happens to be all about. Prior to June, this isn't precisely true, but prior to June, most of what Azure was about was in this line of this continuum of offerings. They were basically sitting in the PaaS section, right? The platform as a service environment, and this particular this continuum is how a lot of organizations happen to look at the underlying infrastructure that they happen to provide. So you anywhere from physical desktops, physical laptops that you happen to have, mobile devices, virtual, you move up from there to virtualizing one single piece of hardware, lots of virtual machines. Then you can move to an infrastructure as a service environment where you have moved stuff out onto Amazon Web Services, AWS, and as it turns out, Azure as well, to platform as a service where you're now developing on top of a platform and you're producing code, creating code, deploying code out on top of that platform to the software as a service world where you are actually providing your software, and that's where a lot of the Salesforce, Office 365, SharePoint Online, Dynamic CRM, those are all fit into that last category. So Azure prior to June really fell into the platform as a service world. You were creating web and worker roles and that's what you were deploying, and that was not a pleasant experience for most developers to work with. It was not a great time. It was not, you actually had to think about it. You actually had to design up front, I'm gonna create this, write it for Azure and off I go. One of the things that changed in June is they completely switched a lot of how they approached the deployment of applications onto Azure. And included, along with what they've always had, which was the platform as a service, they included a number of different offerings that kind of sit into this infrastructure as a service role. Right? The two big ones are Azure Websites and Azure Virtual Machines, we'll be precise. Windows Azure Websites and Windows Azure Virtual Machines. It's the last time I'm gonna say Windows Azure. I'll just say Azure from here on out. I don't have enough syllables in my life to really worry about that. So if you are in the process of trying to deploy anything web-like, Azure Websites is something you should probably give a look at. From a pricing perspective, it's intended to be competitive. It's not the cheapest thing out there. It's not the most expensive thing out there, but it does provide a lot of very, very nice kinds of functionality. Okay, and I believe there's a session, if not later on this afternoon, then first things more, that's actually going to talk about that. The next level up from that is virtual machines. And that's really what we're going to be talking about now. When you're deploying an Azure website, you're basically, it provides a virtual machine for you, but you as the developer or you as the deployer don't get to actually touch it. The machine is there. Management is handled by Microsoft. You push your stuff up there. It runs. That's it. But when you actually go off and deploy a virtual machine, you have full, complete control over what it is you happen to be deploying. Okay, and that's really kind of where the difference happens to lie. So when you take a look at the Azure Virtual Machines world, we're really kind of aiming at a number of different areas here, right? So first of all, one of the big problems that Azure had when it first came out is that if you had developed your own custom application, wanted to deploy it someplace out into the cloud, you weren't able to do so. What Azure VM lets you do now is create a machine, spin it up. It's your machine. It's running Windows Server. It's running Linux. You can deploy anything you want onto it, including your custom applications, including SharePoint, including SQL Server, including TFS. You can deploy any one of those server environments out onto that particular machine, because ultimately it is a machine. It's set up to handle, allow you to manage your storage in a fairly easy, seamless manner, in such a way that if something goes wrong, you can fairly, very quickly get it back. We're going to be talking about that later on in our session. That also fits into the high ability features. There's a lot of functionality, a lot of thought has gone into exactly how, and this is not just simply for VMs, but about across Azure completely, how to ensure high availability. And there's a lot of sophistication that runs behind the scenes to make sure that the high availability is maintained on an ongoing basis. There's a lot of advanced networking features. And what this really comes into, or where this comes into play, is if you are in an organization where you have got some stuff you want running physically on your inside of your office, you have some stuff that's running out on Azure, you can actually extend your network out to Azure, so all the machines appear as if they're in the same domain. You can actually put an Active Directory controller out in Azure and have your local environment use that controller for authentication. Okay, so the advanced networking basically allows you to, if I consider this to be my shell of my normal infrastructure, you can basically push that out to include the stuff that happens to be running inside of the cloud. And as well, and this is almost, for me, it's almost ancillary, you have the ability to integrate with the platform as a service environment. So if you've got web roles, worker roles, the things that Azure used to be, you've got the ability to integrate with that quite easily. So in terms of the kinds of workloads that you can put onto an Azure VM, okay, the list is complete, right? Because if I take a look, I've got line of business apps. So I've got custom applications I can create, put BI out there. I can put CRM applications out there. I can use VMs as a file server, as a database. For identity, as I mentioned, I can put Active Directory out there, TFS, or Subversion, or pick whatever your favorite source control environment happens to be. This is one of the things I happen to love about what you can do with VMs. The time it takes to actually spin up a virtual machine from nothing is about 7 minutes. Okay, so I can basically say, I want a brand new machine that's running Windows 2012 on it, go, and about 7 or 8 minutes later, I've got a machine that's out there that's running that I can connect to. If you are writing any kind of large application and you want some kind of a test environment to work with, the ability to spin up environments that quickly is incredibly useful. If you want to run overnight kind of testing jobs, I can spin up a machine, deploy my application to it, run tests on it, run load tests on it, shut them down again. I don't need any additional hardware. I don't need to have servers sitting around my office that aren't doing anything except waiting for these tests to run. And because of the pricing model that Azure has, it's pay as you use. So the only time you actually will use any of that is when you have it turned on. Okay, so I find if you've got any kind of significant application, be able to push things out quickly is incredibly useful. And then the hybrid application concept. most organizations don't have everything sitting in the cloud someplace else. They want some things kept locally. They want some things put out in the cloud. We're a decently small organization. There's about 25 people in ObjectSharp. We're using Azure, by the way, Azure Virtual Machines, Azure Websites, Office 365, SharePoint Online. We're using a lot of the cloud functions just because we do, because we find it convenient, honestly. We were, as I mentioned before we started the session, we were using Amazon Web Services prior to this. We had VMs hosted up in there, and I also had physical machines sitting in Rack 4 sitting out in Vancouver. We got rid of the Rack 4 servers. We got rid of the Amazon Web Services. We pulled everything into Azure or into our on-premises, and we have got Active Directory authenticating between these two particular environments. We've got networking working out at that particular level. So that ability to hybridize, the ability to, it doesn't really matter where you're putting your stuff. You don't have to design for where you're putting your stuff, is an incredibly powerful thing to be able to do. Now, and you'll see as I, when I actually show, walk through a demo in a couple of seconds, there are a number of images that are available. So these were the images that were available preview. And what I mean by that is, when you go and spin up a brand new Azure virtual machine, you can have a choice. You can either create a what I call a bare machine. So you can basically say, I want some metal. This much RAM, this much CPU, and then you can deploy, install whatever you want onto it. Or you can work from an existing gallery. And these are some of the gallery images that happen to be out there that you could just simply pick from, so that you don't have to do anything to be able to, if you want to create a Windows Server 2012 environment, you just simply go pick it from the gallery, spin it up, and there it is. Okay? You can then install whatever you want to install on it. You'll also notice the presence of penguins on this. Okay? Microsoft, through third-party arrangements that they have, has got so that a number of different distributions for Linux are available to spin up. So just like you can go spin up a Windows Server 2012 box, you can go spin up an Ubuntu box. And then again, customize it to do whatever you happen to want to do on it. And you'll see when I actually, again, when I show you this in a couple of minutes, there's more of them and there will be more added as we happen to go along. Not we go along, not the presentation, so Microsoft continues. Okay. So what you run into is you start the process of actually creating the VM. You've got a number of different steps you have to go through. So if you're trying to create a VM, there's actually three different ways that you can do this. First of all, there is a management portal, and we'll show you what the management portal looks like in a couple of seconds. It's a website. Okay. It's a nice HTML5 website, unlike Silverlight. If you worked with Azure before, previous version of Azure was a Silverlight site. It's now actually an HTML5 site, so you can access it from pretty much any place that happens to have a web. You can also create your virtual machines through scripting. So you can use PowerShell. You can use, they've got scripting applet or scripting objects for Linux and for Macs, so that you can actually write scripts that will create, provision, set up the various virtual machines you have. Also, there's a REST-based API. So you can write your own app. You can mash up if you wish, although I can't really, you know, conceptualize the idea of mashing up a the creation of a virtual machine. But it's a REST-based API. You can create whatever tool you want, use any kind of tool you want to be able to get at it and be able to automate the process or just simply have access to it. As I mentioned, you get to pick the image you want to go from. Whether you want it to be bare metal, you want it to be something from the gallery, or as you'll see shortly, you can create your own images and use that as the basis for which you're creating a virtual machine. There are five different sizes, running from extra small to extra large. Exactly what that means, we'll talk about in a couple of seconds. Generally speaking, it means more memory, more processors, more, there's three of them, bandwidth. Okay, those are generally the three attributes across which it happens to go. And as well, you have the ability to take an image that you have put in storage in Azure and use that as the basis for your for the server that you happen to spin up. Okay, so you do have those options as well. And finally, and this is kind of leading in from that last thing that I said, you've got the ability to take your own VHDs. So your own virtual machines that you're running on-premise, you can load them up into Azure, Okay. So you create your virtual machine. You need to do a couple of things with it. So you basically need to perform a sysprep on it. Okay, which basically genericizes that particular machine for being able to be deployed onto other pieces of hardware. Okay, and then once you do it, you upload the image. It gets put into storage inside of Azure. Okay, and it's not blog storage, it's blob storage. Close, but not quite. You can take that VHD now and use that as the basis for spinning up a new virtual machine. So you can take your virtual hard drive, your VHD files that you've created locally, install everything you want, push it up into Azure, save it in Azure, and then recreate it as you need to, or recreate servers as you need to, simply by going through portal, scripting, REST-based API. Okay. You can also do the following. So you can take VMs that are already out there. So I can take the storage that I have out there, take the base VHD file, create a virtual machine out of it, customize and genericize it. So the idea here is that I can take one of the images that I already have from the gallery, add IIS, add, you know, TFS, add SharePoint, do whatever I want to that particular image, customize it, capture that particular image, storing it still in Azure, and then use that as the basis for creating multiple virtual machines going off into the future. Okay? Or I can take my on-prem VHD, push it up into storage. I can round trip it. So we've already talked about the idea of the VHD going up into Azure, using that as the basis for an image. I can take an image that already exists out there and pull that down and run it on premises. So I can basically take these images and move them back and forth between my premises and Azure, and then back again and forth again, pretty much at will. Okay, so I'm not constrained to where I want to do it, and the format for the image is a VHD. So it's a standard, you know, you load it up into Hyper-V and off it goes. Okay, so it's really very, very mobile in terms of, I mean, your biggest constraint here is that your VHDs can be, you know, 15, 20 gig in size, and, you know, moving them back and forth. It's not like I'm putting them into a little stick and, you know, giving it to another machine. It's a little bit slow to move it up to Azure, but it's slow in terms of minutes and hours. It's not slow in terms of how long would it take for you to create the server from scratch. Now, there is a couple of things that Azure does that makes it interesting from a how they handle persistent disks and how they arrange for durability. And so this is the best way to put this. When you create a virtual machine inside of Azure, it starts off by giving you basically two drives. Okay. It gives you a C drive and a D drive. Okay, the C drive is the operating system environment. The D drive is basically temporary space. And the concept of the temporary space has got to do with the fact that if something happens to the virtual machine, your temporary space goes away. It also provides persistent disk storage. So when you create a virtual machine, you've got the ability, or you, by default, it creates another drive as well on top of the C and the D. This E drive or F drive or whatever you want to call it ends up being persistent. And this is kind of what the diagram gets here. So the idea here is I've got the virtual machine. It's got a C drive. That operating system has access to additional drives, both the temporary storage and persistent storage. That ends up being copied to a place where Azure has access to it in case of disaster recovery. So these particular drives are actually maintained and managed by Azure for recovery. The C drive is, from an operating system perspective, from an installation perspective, the persistent drive, the EF or whatever drive, is managed from a persistency level. The D drive, that temp drive, is not. Okay. And so what happens is if something happens to your virtual machine, okay, which, you know, doesn't happen often, but it does happen, then behind the scenes, it spins up, Azure will spin up another VM using your C drive that's been persisted. Your D drive goes away. Your temp storage is just temp storage. Your application is supposed to, if it's going to store something there, it should expect that at some point it may not be there anymore. In other words, it's only going to store it for short, brief periods of time. But your persistent storage sticks around longer. It also gets backed up and it gets rewired into your rewired into whatever virtual machine that happens to come in. So this gives you a very, very durable, very, from a disaster recovery perspective, it gives you a very nice backup environment for being able to ensure that you've got high availability. It's one of the mechanisms that Azure has for providing high availability for your particular environment that you're working with. I had mentioned earlier that you've got different sizes of virtual machines you can select from. And basically what you're seeing here are the differences between them. So you notice we go from extra small all the way down from extra large. We've got CPU cores. So extra small is shared, which basically means you've got multiple tenants happen to be running on the same virtual machine. You've got, you know, 3/4 of a gig of RAM, 5 megabit bandwidth, or 5 megabits bandwidth. You've got one single data disk. That data disk is the persistent disk that I was talking to you about. The persistent disk can be up to 1 terabyte in size, just so you're aware. Right? As I start to move up, as I go from extra small to small, I stop sharing it. So all of a sudden, my memory capacity goes up to 1 3/4 gig. I've got a lot more bandwidth that I can work with. Right? And it scales all the way up to you know, an 8-core machine with 14 gig of RAM, 800 megabits of bandwidth, and up to 16 terabytes of persistent space that you have access to. Okay, so you get to pick and choose which way you want to go. One of the things that I find interesting about the way the Azure model works, however, your ability to scale up and down from a VM consists of changing a setting. So if you are running an extra small and you're going, crap, Christmas is coming, I need to scale it up, you go into the management portal, you dial it up to an extra large, and Azure takes care of deploying your application out to that new machine. Okay? You get charged for the new machine, naturally, but then when Christmas comes or Christmas finishes and you don't need it anymore, you can just simply dial it back down to an extra small. Okay, and again, Azure takes care of deploying, making the changes, pushing the stuff out to whatever that particular machine happens to be. Okay, so you can scale up and down between these various sizes of machines dynamically. Not instantaneously, I should probably make sure you're aware. It's not an instantaneous process. It does have to create another machine and do all that kind of stuff, but it's on the order of minutes, okay, before you can go back up and down. Okay. So this slide basically talks about what I had already mentioned with respect to, I've got an OS image that is prepared for the virtual machines. This is your C drive. You can create it by uploading it. You can create it by capturing something from the gallery. There's writable disks. And again, there is a the OS disks or the C drive. My data disks are the things that are actually persistent over the course of the running of the application. So let's take a couple of seconds and actually show you what this looks like for real. So I'm going to flip here. Okay, so this is coming through Manage Azure, Manage Windows Azure site. So this is basically what the Azure Management Portal happens to look like. This is what I should, and I should be clear, this is what the new portal happens to look like. Okay, if you actually go in and you're not seeing this, there will be an option through one of these things. There's actually even an option on here that will let you, I won't bother getting to it. There's an option that will let you see, go to the new portal. That will pull you to this particular environment. Okay, and you can see right now I'm showing all of the images or all of the different items that I happen to have running inside of Azure in various shapes and forms. I've got websites, virtual machines, mobile services, cloud services. If you're hanging in the cloud track at all over the next couple of days, you're going to end up hearing about a lot of these different environments and exactly what they mean and how you can go about using them. Virtual machine, I've already got one that happens to be out there, which is nice, but not particularly, I'll hit it in a couple of seconds. To create a new one, I click on the new button. And the new button pops up this little dialog that allows me to create, it's through this dialog that I create any of the new artifacts that happen to be part of Windows Azure. So you'll notice under compute, I happen to have virtual machine. I can do a quick create, which will allow me to specify a DNS name, pick the image, pick the size. Basically what the quick create does is it short circuits a number of the things in the wizard that I'm about to show you. Or I can select it from the gallery. And if I go from the gallery, I have a slightly more formatted version of what I'm looking for. And what you'll see here is, as a starting point, you'll notice I've got BizTalk Server, SQL Server, Windows Server 2008, 2012. I've got a CentOS, I've got a SISI Enterprise, I've got OpenSISI, and a couple of Ubuntu servers. Okay, I can select any one of those, and that becomes the basis for my gallery. If I had created my own images, you would see them in the list of my images. If I had created VHDs that I wanted to come from, you would see them in the list of VHDs that I happen to have uploaded. The mechanism is the same regardless of whether it's coming from the gallery or whether it's coming from an image you create. One of the nice things from a pricing perspective is if you are selecting any of these options, the licensing related to the operating system is included in the cost. So you don't actually need to have a Windows Server 2012 license to run this Windows Server 2012 environment. Okay, it's included in whatever you're gonna be paying for it. Okay, so I'm gonna select that. So here I get to pick my virtual machine. This is the basic configuration. So we'll give it something moderately meaningful. Give it a password. You'll notice I've also got a number of sizes that I can select from. Again, going from extra small to extra large. Next option. I've got the ability to create a standalone virtual machine, or I've got the ability to connect to an existing machine. And we're going to talk more about this in a couple of seconds, or in a little bit later on in the presentation. But if I'm connecting to an existing virtual machine, what I'm basically doing is creating a load balanced environment. Okay, so my connecting to an existing machine says, I've already got a machine out there, I'm adding this one, it's now load balanced, my deployment on one will get deployed onto the other, I will have a load balancer in front of it that redirects traffic from one to the other. Okay, or I can create a standalone virtual machine, in which case I need to give it a DNS name, specify a storage account. Ooh, we'll take that one. It's in the eastern United States. We'll move on past that. Finally, I've got this concept of an availability set. We'll talk about exactly what availability sets are. This is another side to how disaster recovery or high availability is managed from within the Windows Azure world. Okay, so we'll talk to that in a couple of seconds. So if I actually say okay, what you'll see is it's now starting to spin up, and you'll notice right in here you can see it's starting the process of provisioning. So since I've created these, I'm going to get rid of these older messages because I don't care, right? And at the moment it's in the process of creating this virtual machine. Okay, and that's going to take a few minutes to kick up. Now you'll notice I already have a machine that happens to be here running. I've got the ability to go in and attach. Where are you? There we go. So for any one of the particular machines that happens to be up there, you can take a look. You can see what the CPU is, the disk writes. I can take a look at what endpoints happen to be opened for this. I can configure, and this, by the way, is, see my machine size? I can just simply crank it up by just simply changing this value and saving it. Okay, that's all I need to do to be able to make that work. And I can add endpoints to this so that I can specify I want to just add a normal endpoint. I can add a load balancing endpoint, right? And so I can give it just simply an endpoint for TCP or UDP and specify the ports that happen to be open. Basically configure how people are going to be able to see this particular device that's out there. And then as well, I keep wanting to attach something. Okay, and so you just can see, oh, there we go. There's the, this is where the OS disk happens to be. And so I can go through the process of just simply setting up and configuring. And I'll do this right now. You notice down here at the bottom, I have this connect option. And my connect option allows me to open an RDP session. And so now when I create the RDP session, right? All right, so it's establishing the connection, and oh look, I'm talking to my machine, right? So this is now my machine, and I can remote into it and do whatever I want to that machine that I might possibly want to do. Okay, make sense? So that was about, I created that machine, I started that machine probably about an hour ago. It finished about 10 minutes after I got up and going. It takes, like I said, about 7 to 10 minutes to actually spin everything up from scratch. Okay, that's the nice thing about this. It's just that quick and simple to start up a VM. Okay. So, drilling down a little bit more detail about exactly how the virtual machine role fits into everything else that Azure happens to be doing. There's a concept inside of Azure called a cloud service. This came from Azure pre-June, so this is a concept that went back to the beginning, basically, back to your definition of beginning being with about 2 or 3 years ago. Okay, and inside of a cloud service, you would end up with web rules and worker rules, and basically, the web rule was an endpoint that accepted internet connections, so web requests, and a worker rule was a background process that just handled requests that the web rule happened to make, and you would have communications going on between the two. And so you ended up with a cloud service containing multiple roles, and then inside of a cloud service, you could have 1, 2, 3, 10, 15 instances. It was how you scaled up and scaled down Azure. This particular security boundary was built into Azure very deeply. Basically, the idea is that if you create web roles and worker roles and you've got that cloud service surrounding it, you don't have access. People outside of the cloud service don't automatically have access into it. Okay, so that ends up being this nice boundary, and then I can take if you think about the way Azure would be implemented, I can take it and I can move that to different virtual machines in different places, and you as the developer and as the user of these things wouldn't know the difference. Okay, it just simply provided that nice boundary. So the problem you run into, though, is that when you've got a virtual machine, how does that fit into that same boundary in a way that makes sense? And basically what happened is they created a third type of role called a virtual machine role. And the virtual machine role basically is sitting inside of a cloud service, right? And it is only one instance of that particular service. So every single virtual machine has that little bit of isolation, and it can pick up Azure, can pick up that virtual machine and move it to whatever physical machine it wants, and it will still respond appropriately. And if you have got machines that are, for example, load balanced, okay, or machines that are just simply put into an environment where they're shared from one to the other, they will appear as if they're in the same cloud service. So when I have this kind of a scenario set up, excuse me, when I have this kind of a scenario set up, when I've got a cloud service, I've got multiple machines running in, and these machines don't have to be copies of one another, by the way. They don't have to be load balanced. I can create two completely different virtual machines, put them into the same cloud service. These two machines can now communicate one another as if they're on the same local network. So in other words, they can actually communicate with each other by name. They don't have to resolve that to an IP address for them to talk to one another. They're basically in the same subnet. I don't think it's quite as precise as that, but ultimately they share, actually what it is more than anything else is there's a DNS process that they all share. And so you don't have to go, win8pi1.cloud.azurewebsites.net. You can just simply say win8pi, and it will be able to get from one to the other. Okay, and that kind of leads into the concept of networking. Because We're dealing with the virtual machine names. We're dealing with VMs, especially if you're trying to do stuff that might be public. You want control over your machine names. You want control over the DNS on the other side. So you've got a couple of different ways to accomplish this. First of all, you do have full control over your machine names. You create a cloud service. It is actually utilizing the name within your particular environment. It doesn't have the restrictions you have. It's not like if I create a machine called Bruce, nobody else is going to be able to create a machine called Bruce. Okay? When you're creating your VMs, it doesn't work like that. Right? You're really talking about being able to create machine names within your own particular account, within your own area. It will do that by, and this is where so Windows Azure does provide a DNS. If you are resolving machine names within a cloud service, it has a DNS, and it will resolve by name. Okay? And so Windows Azure will provide that. You also have the ability to bring your own DNS server. So if you happen to have a DNS server on-prem, or you've got a DNS server someplace else, or you've set it up with, I don't know, GoDaddy because you happen to like race cars, then you can use that DNS service as well. And you can now configure Azure, you can configure your machines to use that particular DNS service. So you've got the ability to have public DNS and have your virtual machines hit. Right? One of the things that we talked about just before we got started was, or actually even at the beginning, was the concept of Azure websites versus Azure versus the virtual machines and where they fit on the continuum, right? That DNS capability is a big part of that continuum, right? You'll find that you can have Azure websites for more or less free. You can actually get a gig of database and a place to host for less than $10 a month, and that's assuming you don't have ways to get it for free. You're on BizSpark, you have an MSDN subscription, you can get those, you can get, you know, a number of those things at no cost at all, okay? You do, however, have to give up the right to have your own name. In other words, if I'm willing to have bruce.azurewebsites.net, then I can get by for free or very close to free. If I want to have objectsharp.com, I have to pay for it, okay? So there's a shared website model that you happen to have. If I want to be able to take that a step farther and put it on my name, or have my virtual machine on my DNS, right? I've now gone from free websites to low-cost websites to virtual machines. Virtual machine I can name however I want because it's just a machine sitting on the internet and I have a DNS provider and that's how I get my machine names. So that's the kind of scaling that you happen to have, and that is where the costing and the choices that you make happen to come in. From a protocol perspective, right? You notice that when I was in looking at that particular VM, I could configure either TCP or UDP endpoints, both of which are completely supported on any port that you happen to want to have available to you, right? I can have port forwarded endpoints. So again, when I was creating the virtual machine, I had the ability to add it to an existing load balancing environment, and I can now have one single endpoint come through, and it can have multiple different physical virtual machines. The load balancer is available, and there's a health check that is done behind the scenes to ensure the health of the virtual machines that happen to be out there. All right. So I've got support for all of these protocols. So I've got, you know, TCP, UDP, I can do pings, I can specify ports dynamically. All of that is available and configurable through this. And so what you end up with is this kind of scenario. So if I have got a single public IP, and I've got multiple VMs behind it, each of which is listening on a particular port, I can configure inside of the load balancer the idea that I've got these two different IP port, these two different IPs coming in, okay, and they're going to two different. They can either appear to go to a single machine, or they can go to the individual machines. And this is one of the ways that virtual machines allows for remote access, because if I've got two virtual machines and I've got them behind this kind of a scenario, so I've got a load balancer out front, or they're supposed to be to the public, they're a single IP address, even if they're two physical machines, or two physical virtual machines, if they're two virtual machines, right? I've got two different scenarios in which I want to access these machines. One, through the public IP address, and I no longer care which machine it hits. Two, if I need to go and configure one of the machines, if I need to go and update it, patch it, I have to be able to hit those machines directly. And so through this single, through a public port, you've got the ability to say, okay, I'm hitting this IP address, load balancer, figure out which machine's gonna handle the request, or through a completely different port, I can go specifically to one of the two machines. Okay, and that's really where that RDP, the connectivity, happens to come in. If I'm RDPing into that machine, then I'm gonna go directly through the port to that virtual machine I'm talking to. If I come through the physical IP or through the public IP, it's gonna hit it based on what the load balancer happens to go, where the port forwarding happens to go, right? And so you can build out the kind of scenario where you have got multiple virtual machines running the same software, different version, or running the same application. Single port 80 load balancer will just simply redirect it, and this becomes what's called a load balance set. Okay. And you can do the same thing so that, for example, you can specify a probe pass. So the idea here is you can build up inside of your load balancer, you can specify a health check page. So that you can say for each one of the virtual machines, if you respond to this health check, I'll know whether I should include you in the load balancing algorithm or not. Okay, so there's support inside of Azure for that kind of custom probing for health checks to ensure that a particular machine happens to be there. Which kind of brings us into, nicely, into the idea of availability. Okay, and so for availability, what you're really looking at is two things. First of all, from Azure's perspective, from Microsoft's perspective, there are two levels of service level agreements. First of all, there is what's called a single role instance. If you create a single virtual machine, okay, the SLA is 99.9%, so that's just over 8 hours of downtime a year. Of unexpected downtime a year. If, on the other hand, you create a load-balanced environment, two or more virtual machines using a load balancer get up, they now guarantee the service level agreement is now 99.95%. Okay, so that's like 3.5 nines. Okay, now this includes hardware failure, data center failures, you know, upgrade failures, planned downtime as well. So if there's any planned downtime, there is a 6-day notice, a 6-hour window, and you're guaranteed no more than 25 minutes of downtime. And as we talk about the next couple of slides, I'll show you how they mitigate the impact that might have onto the ongoing operation of your environment. What this does not include, and this makes sense if you think about it, crashes by third-party software. Okay, you write an application that happens to take a machine down, yeah, that's not included in the SLA. Go figure. Okay, that's how they manage out the service level agreements. Now, the way they handle or the way they work to mitigate the impact that updates, patches, a normal maintenance might have to you is through this concept of fault and update domains. Okay, so a fault domain is conceptually a group of resources that would be anticipated to fail together. Easiest way to think about this, if you think about what you would do if you were rolling this out physically, if you had a rack inside of a server room, okay, that rack has a single power source, that power source goes out, all of those machines are going to be affected. Okay? So that concept of a fault domain is you've got if you think of this as a vertical slice through your machines, I've got these machines that I expect to go down. And if I want reliability, what I really want to do is have two identical stacks on two different racks, right? So I might have a web server, an application server, a database server here. I've replicated them over here. So now if this rack goes down, I still have this other identical working environment that can handle all the incoming load. That's the concept of a fault domain. An up domain is a collection of resources that will be grouped, will be updated together. Okay, so I have got, when I'm dealing with the kind of updates I'm talking about would be patches made to the Windows operating system, patches made to IIS, patches made to SQL Server. Now, if you've got Windows Update running, those patches can happen pretty much any time. And so this becomes kind of a horizontal slice, okay? If I take a look at my web, if I take a look at those same two stacks, I've got two web servers. I want to make sure that those web servers are not updated simultaneously. Because if they're updated simultaneously, they'll bring my entire stack down. Okay? And so the way this used to work, or conceptually, if I look at a web role and a worker role, and I've got different instances, what you would find is I have got, as a fault domain, this vertical slice, and as an update domain, this horizontal slice. I want to make sure that there's at least one web role instance running at all times. Okay, I want to make sure there's at least one worker role instance running at all times. And so you have that horizontal and vertical a visualization to what happens to go on. So fault domains are the vertical, and then my update domains end up being set up like this. Okay, so that I can update these two things simultaneously, those are fine. Update these two instances simultaneously, I still have the other roles that happen to be running. Right? In the virtual machine world, these availability sets and the fault domain update domain model is honored by the virtual machines that you've set up. Right? So you define an availability set. If you recall when I was going through the process of creating a VM, I had the ability to add a VM to a particular availability set or create a brand new one. And so what you do here is, again, you'll notice I've got my two vertical stacks of IIS and a SQL server. I define this availability set between the two IIS virtual machines and an availability set beside the two SQL server virtual machines, right? They will be conceptually, that becomes my update domain. And then I've got the concept of a rack going up and down, and that I don't mind if I lose one IIS and one SQL, but I want to make sure that I'm not losing my two IISs. And so that's what the availability set does. And so when you get this configured, the Azure Fabric, which is more or less the software that controls where the virtual machines are running and how things are deployed and where things happen to be moving, will honor those particular availability sets when it comes to doing updates. So when an OS update happens to come out, it will make sure that it's not doing the update on both of the two IIS machines simultaneously. So you don't have that particular problem anymore. Right? And it just simply builds it out so that automatically it says, okay, so here's my update domain, here's my fault domain, and it will follow those two models to figure out how things happen to be going. And this really kind of relates back to the SLA, right? So again, single virtual machine, 99.9%. If I put two virtual machines inside the same availability set, then all of a sudden I've got a 99.95 is what I happen to be, that's the guarantee that I happen to have. And so this gives me this redundancy at every level that I might possibly want. So I've got two web roles talking to two SQL Server databases. I can set up mirroring between the two so that the data is being pushed back and forth. Right? I have an availability set that relates to the SQL side. I have an availability set that relates to the IIS side. And I have a very nice redundancy for the environment that I happen to be working in. Right? And so this is how, I mean, if you actually look at this, this is kind of the traditional way of thinking about high availability setups. Okay, where I'm replicating my SQL servers, I'm replicating my websites, load balancing between them. Okay. And this kind of kicks back into the things we were talking about before, because if you take a look at any one of the particular machines that happens to be there, right, I can add, here's my Win8PI1. You'll notice I already have this availability set that happens to be here. I can go into Win8.2. I'm assuming it's up and running now. Let's do a quick check and see. It's still provisioning, unfortunately. This is the downside about trying to do this live. So basically the idea is that when this is up and running, when that machine is up and running, you'd be able to go into the configuration side and just simply add it to an availability set or create an availability set or move it from different availability sets to different availability sets. Okay, so basically when you're configuring this, you need to think of an availability set is, here's a group of virtual machines that I don't want to go down simultaneously. And it will take, and Azure will take care of the rest. Okay? So from a connectivity perspective, there's a number of different ways you can sync data. And what you're looking at here is how do I get from my on-premises, if you look at the enterprise side, to my cloud. And depending upon exactly the data that I want to be able to move and how I want to do it, I've got a number of different choices. So first of all, at the very top level, I've got, if I want to do data synchronization, there's actually something called SQL Data Sync that will allow me to push data back and forth between an on-prem SQL database and a SQL Azure database. Okay. If I've got application connectivity and messaging, if I have processes running on my on-prem environment and I want to be able to send messages out to the cloud services, I have got Service Bus. There's an Azure Service Bus that I can create that connects up between the two. Okay. Now, those are application level connectivity. If, on the other hand, I want to get down to the network level connectivity, I've got two other choices. I've got something called Windows Azure Connect, and I've got Windows Azure Virtual Network. And the difference between the two, generally speaking, is machine-to-machine connectivity, so allow two machines to talk to one another, versus site-to-site connectivity, which is much more of the, when I talked about extending your active domain out to the cloud. Right? And so the idea here is, you're trying to find ways to be able to extend your on-prem out into Windows Azure. Okay, and that's really what the Windows Azure Virtual Network allows you to do. Okay, there's a lot of I will tell you right now, there's a lot of thought that has to go into setting up Windows Azure Virtual Network properly. Okay, it's not for the faint of heart. This is hardcore networking stuff. It's not that it's rocket science, but it's not also the kind of thing that you can do on a whim. You need to think about exactly what it is you're pushing out, what ports end up being open. You've got to actually have that level of awareness of security and connectivity between the two, and you really need to plan this out. Okay, it's not the kind of thing that you can just simply go, hey, I want to create a virtual network now. Okay, you have to do some prep work up front to make sure that you're doing things the way you want to do them to get the functionality that you happen to want. You can get a lot of the functionality, if not all of the functionality you're likely to need. You have the ability to push out into Azure. You'll notice the way that lays out. I've got two virtual machines running on a subnet. Now that's basically two virtual machines in the same cloud service. I might have a role, a web role, a worker role, running on another subnet. I end up with a virtual network configured between that particular Azure instance back into my network, so I've extended my network out to Azure. Okay. At that point, you have the ability, this becomes a private network. So the relationship I have between the Azure machines here and my internal network is if they're on the same network. Okay. I could have something in my virtual machine communicate with a database server that's running back on-prem, as if both of them were running on-prem. Okay, so you've got that kind of connectivity that happens to be available to you. Okay, so the question that you have, and this is, again, comes from the planning. What kind of requirements do you happen to need, right? So if I want to deploy virtual machines into a network, do I need persistent IP addresses? Do I have things on my on-prem that no needs to talk to the IP address? Can it use DNS to resolve them? Right. Do I have connectivity between my data center and the cloud that I need to be able to handle? What ports are they going through? What kind of information are they being pushed across? What kind of endpoints do they want? Right. Do I want to put Active Directory up in the cloud? Do I want to have the cloud use Active Directory on-prem as its authentication mechanism, as its authorization mechanism? So those are the kinds of choices that you have to make. And all of them are possible. They just require some configuration. Also, and this is an area where the choices that you see here, the IaaS and PaaS, is an area where I haven't found to be a ton of stickiness yet, okay? Because the PaaS for Azure is the old style web role, worker role, okay? People aren't thinking that way yet when they write applications. One of the very, very cool things about Azure websites and Azure virtual machines, you don't have to decide that that's where you want to deploy it at the time you start writing. Okay. Create yourself a PHP website. Deploy it to Azure websites. Deploy it to virtual machines. I don't care. You don't have to decide that at the time you're writing it. Write it, do it, deploy it. You can pick whichever one you want to go based on how big you think your market's going to be. Okay, so it's not something you have to think about up front. The platform of a service, as a service, you do have to think about up front. You actually have to plan for it. You have to say, okay, so I'm anticipating running this through Azure. I'm going to create a web role. I'm going to create a worker role. Now, are there benefits to creating web roles and worker roles? Absolutely. My ability to dial a web role up instantaneously exists. I can't do that with virtual machines. I can't do that with websites. I have minutes it may take to spin up another VM, right? It may take me minutes to spin up a new website or to extend my increase the size of my website, but it's not instantaneous, where spinning up a web role or a worker role, you know, change the number from a 1 to a 10, how long does it take to create 9 new processes? That's as long as it takes to spin up. Okay, so you just have to plan for it, though. You have to design for that kind of environment. Now, there are as ups and downs to the platform as a service, right? The platform as a service, you can get to development faster. I'm kind of a little iffy on that one, because unless you've actually worked in the Windows Azure web role worker role, I would say that's probably not true. People know how to do PHP. People know how to do MVC. People know how to do ASP.NET. They already know that. The amount of work you have to do to get from a web application to a web role is not great, but it's non-zero. Okay. I prefer the idea of developers, especially ones that are trying to move in a fast environment, work as quickly as they reasonably can, get what they need to get, you know, work an environment they're comfortable and familiar with, and then worry about the other stuff later on, which is why I tend to prefer recommending the virtual machines or websites over web roles and worker roles. Okay. There is an element of expense. It is cheaper, if you have any kind of a significant app you're creating, it is cheaper to use the platform as a service. So creating web roles and worker roles is cheaper than creating a virtual machine. You know, we haven't talked about the cost at all. There is actually, if you take a look in the environment here, there is actually a nice little pricing calculator so that you can see, you know, how much things cost. And so right now I'm looking at the websites. I'm going to go to the full calculator just because it's, you know, a little easier to, you know, handle things, right? So if I have a website, right, you'll notice up to 10 of them are free. If I go to a shared one, $9.36 for my first shared website. The difference between free and shared is free, it's bruce.azurewebsites.net. Shared is objectsharp.com. Okay? That's the difference. Okay? And then I can go to reserved, which is I now have my own machine. Okay? I'm now running on my own machine. You'll notice that I can pick small, medium, and large, which is roughly the same size as I can pick for VMs. Right? Virtual machines. An extra small virtual machine is $9.36 a month. Kind of like the same thing as a website. What's the difference between the two? Well, the difference is you don't get to remote into your website machine. You deploy your application and it works. Virtual machine, you get to remote into it and install whatever you want on it. You're now responsible for managing all the stuff you install. Okay, so for those of you that happen to be, you know, anal about controlling stuff, you can get yourself a VM and install whatever you want on it, and you have to manage upgrading it and maintaining it and all of the, from a software perspective, not from a hardware perspective, right? But the cost is the same. You go from there to a small instance, you'll notice that the price, $57.60, is the same as what a reserved website happens to be. That's how the pricing happens to work out. The only other cost you have related to any of this, by the way, is, and by the way, my web role, worker role instance, you know, this ends up being on a cost per hour basis. So my web role worker role is like two cents per hour of compute time that gets used. That can be less expensive or more expensive depending upon how many instances you happen to have running. And the only other cost you have, by the way, just so you're aware, your SQL database, right, is cheap. 100 meg is $5 a month. And my bandwidth, you know, is, where's the number I can actually, there you go, 6 cents a gigabyte. Okay, so those are basically the costs that you happen to be looking at for this, right? So the cheaper side to this is not just simply pure cost, but pure but management cost as well. Platform as a risk, or platform as a service is a lower risk. The platform does more. Basically, all you're doing is writing code and deploying it out there. Okay, it's not you're not doing as much. You're not working with IIS. You're not working with PHP directly. The things that can go wrong end up being less. And I'm not saying you're not testing stuff, that you can actually mitigate that particular risk, but that happens to be the way the web roles worker role happen to work. Now, these two environments do work side by side. So if you do have web roles and worker roles, and I'm going to tell you right now, there are times when a web role or a worker role makes sense. Okay, web roles are great if you've got an endpoint that you need to serve up some kind of data. Okay, because it's only going to be up there for, it becomes a nice public endpoint. I don't need an entire website for it. The infrastructure surrounding just simply exposing an endpoint for some data or for some functionality is quite nice. Okay, and if you want an example of that, check out the mobile, Windows Azure Mobile Services. Okay, which basically is a data endpoint to an unstructured database. Okay, again, there's sessions on that later on, and if you have never looked at what Windows Azure Mobile Services can do for storing information coming from a phone or coming from a tablet, take a look at it because it's very, very slick in terms of what it kind of offers. So that ability is quite nice, but you can connect with, when I'm dealing with these two things side by side, I can connect these applications, I can connect both my web role, worker role, platform as a service things into the same cloud service used by my VMs. I've got connectivity using the virtual network, so they can reach back into my own environment. And so you end up with a couple of different approaches that you can take to being able to spread these things out across your local and your cloud. So you do have the kind of scenario where if I'm trying to access SQL data through a public endpoint, I can arrange so that my SQL server is sitting inside of inside of a firewall, inside of a cloud service, and I can basically going through this, and you're looking at certain port access to be able to get at that SQL Server database. I can have my SQL data accessed through a public endpoint, through an HTTP point, where I'm simply exposing stuff out again. This particular environment, in terms of its approach, where I'm going through a single load balancer, and the load balancer is either going internally or across to the cloud, is nice from a setup perspective. It's very, very easy to set up, but it tends to be less secure. My data point happens to be exposed. It's got a higher latency because I'm using basically HTTP traffic to communicate between the various cloud services that happen to be out there. Right? If I'm using virtual networking, becomes tougher to set up, but a much faster environment. So this is the same basic idea. Here's my load balancer with port 80. Okay, and so just so you can kind of understand my difference, right? So the idea here is I want to be back here. So the idea here is if somebody hits port 80 and a cloud service needs some web information comes back out through the internet back into a SQL Server database running on port 1433. Okay, so I'm kind of doing my round trip. Request comes in here, it comes out, back in through another public access port and talks to my database. Okay. If, on the other hand, you have this kind of a setup, so that I have a virtual network set up between my web role and my database, now all of a sudden I'm not going back across the public internet to get there. Request comes in, it uses the virtual networking to go directly through what is basically a secure channel. Okay, lower latency, more secure, easier to swap out things in the cloud and not have it impact anything, but I end up having to do set up virtual networking, which is more complex, and I have to provide a DNS, because the virtual networking here is going to depend upon being able to talk down into here, and that means that you have to provide that DNS back up to the cloud. Okay, so as you can see, we've kind of run the gamut here from really simple, right? Take a virtual machine, push it out there, deploy stuff on it, off you go. To I can set up some very, very sophisticated networking scenarios that allow me to have both on-premises and cloud-based services running on different VMs, communicating back and forth across different ports. In other words, I can pretty much do whatever I need to do to have an application running in the cloud. Okay, and that's where the VMs get you. This is a full-on, full-scale, your machine, your control. We can set the networking up the way you want to go. That's the choice that you happen to face. And like I said, you go from websites where it's an easy deploy out to virtual machines where it's a complicated deploy. Azure can handle that up and down the entire spectrum. And the fact that I can do that with the same technology, really not changing that much of anything as I move up and down the stack, is an incredibly powerful way to develop your applications. Okay? So that would be the end of my presentation. A couple of things to be aware. First of all, Microsoft is using a third party for session evaluations. I would greatly appreciate it if you have a chance to fill out the session evals. It would be, I won't say I live and die by them, but I love hearing the comments that people have, because it's the only way that you actually get to improve sessions and session content that happens to be out there. It's important to be aware of, this is being done by a third party. There is no personal information that's being collected or preserved. Okay, so, you know, it's, I think there's two questions in it, which is, you know, more or less, did you like this, and, you know, did I suck? Let's simply go with those. I have no idea what the questions are, to be fair. But your privacy is being maintained with this. Okay, and so you can find your session eval at w8pi.ca/cld2eval. And again, if there's any questions, I'm more than happy to answer and address them. If not, then thank you. Sir? Yes. Certainly. So I'm going to repeat this because there's an online audience. So I had mentioned that ObjectSharp had moved from a RackForce Azure website or Azure Web Services environment to running things in the cloud. The question was, what was our cost savings? Cost savings was roughly 50 to 60%, which, I mean, we're not talking about huge environments, but we saved like $1,000 a month by making that kind of a move. Okay. Now, are there things that we didn't do that there were things we didn't do because of cost? One of them was we didn't push things into Active Directory. So we're using Active Directory on-prem rather than Active Directory in the cloud. One of the reasons being that cost metric for Active Directory is how many authentications you perform. Okay. And just simply because most of our guys are a lot of different places, we found that cost-wise, that wasn't an effective use. But our website's running on Azure websites, okay? Because, you know, all I have to do is just simply, it's a ASP.NET MVC site, and you push it out there, and off it goes. But yeah, we found it was about 56% savings is what we got out of it. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, sir. Yep. Okay. Okay, so the question is, in the Azure world right now, 8 processes seems to be the max. Can I get something that's running like 100 cores, more or less, I think is what you're asking for. At the moment, not on a single physical machine. right? There's nothing stopping you from having, I mean, this now becomes an application design thing, right? There isn't anything out there that will let me just simply add more cores, right? There's a physical side to the to how Azure is running in the data centers that I think would prevent that from happening. But there's nothing stopping you from running an application across 12 8-core machines. And I know clients who have done exactly that. You know, we need to load test this kind of thing. We need to do this processing. So what they'll do is they'll spin up, you know, 12 8-core machines for 24 hours, and then they'll shut them down again. Okay? So I've seen people do that kind of functionality, but their application has to be designed to run on multiple machines versus running on 100 cores inside of a single box. Does that answer the question? Yes. Yes. And you're right. If I'm running out between two machines, I'm going to have less fast communication between them. No question at all. But there isn't anything that I'm not aware of anything in Azure that will let you get up to 100 cores, for example. 8 seems to be the max at the moment. Okay. Sir. How about GPU cores? I don't know the answer to that question. I would think that because these machines aren't really intending to be running graphics processing, they're servers. Do you know what I'm saying? This is me speculating. I don't know what GPU cores they might have. So it's certainly not in the criteria for this extra small to extra large. Okay? Anything else? Okay, well, thank you so very much for your time. Hopefully it was useful. Enjoy the rest of the show. For those of you that are planning on staying up.